Your financial legacy with Brunch and Budget is brought to you by Brookdale's Community College Opportunity Grant, CCOG, Tuition Free Brookdale. Financial aid is tuition justice. Please, please, I'm going to drop some information in the chat right now. Please tell your loved ones, brookdalecc.edu/tuition-free. Free tuition for anyone in a household making under $65,000 a year. Now Governor Murphy is signing into legislation, moving that up to anyone in a household making under $80,000 a year. So we're moving towards that forward movement. Please enjoy yourselves. Please have a good time. I'm so glad to have Brunch and Budget here to guide us to light the way. I see some folk who've been here with us, right? Sasha and Kevin and some folk and some students. Hi, JP. So please light it up in the chat. And I'm going to turn the mic over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Angela.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Glad to have y'all here. Glad to have y'all back. Glad to have the new people too. We'll be going through some of the stuff for the new heads and for the people who've been here. We'll be getting a little bit deeper.
Yes, we will. All right, everybody, this is it. This is stage three, financial sustainability. We are very excited about the stage.
Well, this is the stage that everybody feels like they're supposed to be at. We have this idea in our head that sustainability means that we're all good, that we're coasting. The thing that I've found is that this is actually the most work, this stage right here. I think the two after that, that's like momentum is kind of carrying you.
Yeah.
But this one requires a lot because this is where you have to make a lot of decisions.
Yeah, that's a really good point because you have to make a lot of decisions that I feel like don't come from like you learning finances through osmosis, right? It's the kind, it's the stage where it's like, okay, now I might have to like get an advisor. Now I might have to like learn things separately from what I've just picked up along the way. And so we're really excited to have you here and really just break down what this looks like. So as we start every workshop, please remember that Brunch and Budget is a registered investment advisor. So please do not construe anything we tell you today as financial advice. It is for educational purposes only.
Again, we don't know enough about your personal financial situation to give you accurate advice, and we don't want to do you dirty. You will be having access to these slides so you can read all of the fine print. We should put a joke in there somewhere or something.
Yes. Oh, we'll be sending you the slides. Yay. Give us a few days. Angela will be sending you the slides if you RSVP'd for this workshop.
As usual, our expectations and reality, you know, I guess this is the thing that I was saying about how you have to make decisions at this stage that give you different trajectories.
Yeah.
This is where you start deciding, well, what does enough look like? What do I want out of life? How connected to these systems do I really want to be? Mm-hmm. Do I want to own a big home where I've got all the internet access and I'm jet setting and traveling around the world? Or do I want to start cutting myself off from things so I can just focus on myself and my family or anything in between?
Yeah, this is where the reality side of it starts to become a place where things feel more concrete. And if you've never been there, you're here for the first time, that can also start to feel overwhelming and terrifying. So keep that in mind. That's totally normal to feel that way. And we're here to guide you through it as well.
Yeah. When that part of you that likes to self-sabotage starts to rise up as you're looking at the account, remember that's part of the process too.
Yes, exactly. And if you're on your way to the stage, just know that feeling is coming. That whole like fear of success thing. That's what I feel like stage three is, right? All right. So if this is your first time here, hi, I'm Pamela Capallet. I'm a certified financial planner and accredited financial counselor. I'm the founder and CEO of Brunch and Budget, which is a full service financial planning practice, and the co-founder of Pockets Change, which is a hip hop and finance program for youth.
And hi, I'm Dialect. I'm the director of pedagogy at Pockets Change. I've been an educator for nearly 20 years now and also a creative entrepreneur. All of the mistakes, problems, hangups, and issues you've had with money, I've done at least three times.
Yeah, I remember that.
You remember plenty of them. And to bring us back and keep it moving forward, we have DJ KK47 riddling you with knowledge, good tunes, and good vibes.
Yes, yes. Please book DJ KK47. The link tree is down here. She is the people's DJ. She has an MSW and she is an artivist. And thank you for dropping that in the chat, KK47. Love it.
I like the term artifice. I feel like most artists are artifice, even if they don't think they are.
I know. So Brunch and Budget has been in, one of the big missions for Brunch and Budget is to really bring this information in particular to communities of color and other marginalized groups. And I have had the fortune of actually being featured in a couple of industry publications, Financial Planning Magazine and Financial Advisor Magazine.
Not fortune, though. You said I had the fortune of being.
I've had the fortune of, not, but I haven't been on Fortune yet. That's true. That's true. And we have also been in New York Magazine, Forbes, Blavity, and Bloomberg as well, specifically featured for really bringing financial literacy to different levels and different folks. So please, we invite you to ask questions at any point in time. Stop us if we're going too fast or if you want something explained again. We are here for you and we're here to make this a conversation. So how did this all start?
Yeah, Brunch and Budget start?
Brunch and Budget really is all about making financial planning accessible. And Brunch and Budget literally started with me offering to trade food for advice. It was friends who were scared to look at their finances, asking me about them at parties. And one day someone came up to me and said, Pam, I've never checked my credit score before, but I'm so afraid to look. And I said to her, do you want to do it over brunch or something? That's literally how it started. And how it's going is Brunch and Budget is now a full service financial planning practice with multiple financial planners. And all of us have the same mission to really make this information as accessible as possible. And we're also hoping to do our part to close the racial wealth divide.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things for our people is whenever folks are like, well, why are you talking about yourself in the beginning here? This is something we had to build for ourselves. As we share the things that are useful for you, folks need to know that you have expertise. So when you're sharing the things about your business, feel free to do that too. Our core values at Brunch and Budget are to empower and advocate people.
Celebrate, don't sugarcoat.
Be fanatical about getting it right.
And practice radical acceptance.
Which means we have to figure out ways to forgive ourselves. Because if we don't forgive ourselves, we don't let go of the harmful actions we've been doing to sabotage what we got going on.
Yes. And we mentioned this before, personal finance is a revolutionary act. We truly believe that when you feel empowered in your finances, when you feel like your spending is in line with your values, you prioritize having a savings cushion, even above paying down debt, when you have a good credit score, when you learn how to invest and you take advantage of the retirement system, when you file your tax, when you have an estate plan, all of these things don't feel like a big deal if you're doing them. But think about how it feels when your taxes aren't filed. When you don't have an estate plan, when you don't have an estate plan, when you don't have a good credit score, what kinds of things don't you have access to, right? And so when you get your personal finances in order, you put yourself in a position where you're able to advocate for yourself and for your community.
Yeah. So these are the five stages. We already did financial safety and financial stability. This time is financial sustainability.
And then we have financial independence is stage 4 and financial legacy is stage 5. Those are coming up in the next 2 weeks. Join us for those. We love those workshops. That's when it gets really fun too.
If you go to bit.ly/BNB stages, we have a worksheet for you to fill out. Always remember to take it and make a copy for yourself so you can actually fill out the job.
Yes.
If you look at the top, we have the financial stages and going down the side are the categories.
Okay. All right. And if you've been following along, keep following along, filling this form out. So the first stage that we went through a couple weeks ago is financial safety.
And financial safety looks like you're unsure of where your money's going. Your bills feel out of control. You got a lot of debt and it feels unmanageable. You have little to no savings. It always disappears and you need a foundation.
Yeah, a lot of us start here and a lot of us are here when we come into our finances because we weren't taught this in schools, right? This is not something our parents taught us because their parents didn't teach them. This is not something we got in schools. And I'm like, I know exactly why. But when you're in this stage, your goal is to start saving regularly, organizing your bills, your credit, and your debt. And really, it's about habit building in the safety stage, starting to learn the financial terms and getting comfortable with them and increasing your income if needed.
Last time we talked about stability, which looks like you're having a saving cushion. You have debt, but it is not increasing or not increasing at a great rate. You're learning more about investing. You're doing a lot of figuring things out right now, and you still might be a paycheck or two away from financial trouble.
Yes. So in the stability stage, the goal to get from stability to sustainability is all about maintaining habits, increasing your regular savings, starting that debt pay down plan, increasing your credit score, starting to invest in stability for the first time, putting together your insurance, you can start protecting the wealth you've started accumulating and continue to increase your income.
This time we're talking about sustainability, where we are establishing these habits and our savings and making the savings habit something that's concrete and building on it. We are auto paying our bills comfortably, decreasing our debt and getting our retirement investments together and increasing
them. Yes. So the goals for this stage, again, this is what Dialect was saying about, this is the time where it starts to, you start to really make decisions and those concrete goals start really coming into vision for you, right?
Those things that are dreams that you never really thought would become a reality are now options and available to you. So when are you going to do them?
Yeah. The other thing is, it is time to really start protecting your wealth. At this stage, you've accumulated some wealth. So how do you start protecting it? And you can start protecting it if you're in safety or stability as well. So by the time you get to sustainability and your finances get more complex, you will have a good foundation. You also may be able to max out your retirement contributions. What that means for, if you have a 401k, for instance, is you're putting $20,000 away every year into your retirement contributions. Mm-hmm. Yeah, or more.
And for our next workshop, same brunch time, same brunch channel, independence, which looks like you're working because you want to and not because you have to. We'll get deeper into that when we talk about that next time. Yep, yep. You have no credit card debt or only temporary when you need it for, want it for stuff. And you have enough money that you can fund extended time off. You can take that 6 months off and write that book you wanted to.
Yes. Your goals here are to explore other investment opportunities outside of your retirement accounts to determine what is truly enough for you. We talk about enough a lot because, you know, getting through these stages is all about knowing what that number is. Whatever it is will determine what your concrete goals are, will determine how quickly or how slowly you can and want to go through these stages. And then really in independence, you're making sure your wealth is fully protected through insurance and estate planning.
I know it seems like when you get to independence and this next stage legacy, it's like, well, how do I even fathom those things when I'm in the earlier stages trying to get my stuff together? But it's really important that we start looking at the entire through line of what we want our life to look like. If we don't make space in our life for financial legacy, we're just not going to get there.
Yeah. And we'll always just be treading water in financial stability. If you don't know what the end goal could even look like, right? Mm-hmm. And legacy looks like your investments are funding your lifestyle. You're able to contribute significantly to your community. You don't need a credit score. Can you imagine not caring about what your credit score is?
And again, if you don't know what this looks like in the future and you feel like you need some perfect expertise, you don't. Just guess. That's what the folks who end up in this place do. They guess and either it's the right thing or it's different and they change it.
Yes. Paid in full. Exactly. Right. I love it.
Thinking of a master plan.
Yes.
So when you're going through these stages, I want you to take inventory of yourself. I want you to do the five-year-old test and ask yourself why. Why am I dealing with these systems of wealth inequality? Why am I allowing myself to be discriminated against? The racial wealth divide, the capitalism of it all. What am I doing here that makes it worth it for me to be living, pushing, fighting, struggling through these systems, even the ones that are rewarding me?
Yes, exactly. And it's also important for you to really, especially at this stage, start to understand what your relationship with money is and come to terms with it, right? Mm-hmm. What imposter syndrome are you facing at this stage? Is it holding you back from getting to this stage, right? Mm-hmm. What money history do you have that you need to work through? What habits are helping you survive but not helping you thrive? What hustle are you in? Do you feel burned out? Is that what's keeping you from moving forward?
I was just reading something about how burnout is something that one of the big problems with burnout is that we're told to try to get over it too quickly. And that sometimes takes years for you to really get over the burnout when you've hit the end of your thing.
Well, it took years for you to get there potentially too.
Exactly. Yeah. It takes years for you to get burned out. So it's always going to take you time to get out of these things. And again, we want you to be able to understand and forgive yourself for these things because that's how we move forward.
Yes. And again, remember, you are not wrong. You're not stupid and you are not alone. We are here with you every step of the way.
When you believe that you're wrong, stupid, and alone, that's when they get you. The they is all of the random folks that would like some money from you and doesn't care about your budget or your goals.
Yep.
So talking about these things that just don't go away, historical racism, we were talking about how there is racism in the tipping industry. We were talking before about how there's racism in the insurance industries with dead peasants insurance. Did we talk about dead peasants insurance?
We're going to talk about it next week.
Oh, that's right. We're going to talk about that next week. I forget which order. There are a lot of foundational things about our economic systems that come from institutional racism that affects all of us. So important for us to understand these systems, talking about how people believe that Black people should be in service because we are not worthy of being voters, and that people who are worthy of being voters should not be in service to each other. Those ideas started a long time ago, continue today, and continue to affect us economically, us personally, and the communities we live in. So we're going to go to our money quiz. Those of us who've been here before, you know this test. Those of us who are new, take these for yourself. For our old heads who are like, oh, I know about the money personalities. I got mine.
I know mine. What mine is.
I would like you to take this money personality test for a spouse, coworker, friend,
family member,
someone parent. Who you spend a lot of time and energy talking about or thinking about money with.
Yes.
And one of the big things about these money personalities is understanding for yourself, but also understanding the relationships you have with people and their relationships with money.
Yes, absolutely. I love it when couples take this together. It's always fun to see. It's always fun to see how they react.
We can talk a little bit about the couple-y stuff when we go into the answer code.
I think
that'll be helpful.
We will. So question one, what do you relate to more? Do you A, think more about what you have in the bank now and it's not real until it's in your account?
Or B, are you usually spending the next check in your head before it hits the account?
Yes, and feel free to put your answers in the chat. And two, what do you relate to more? Do you A, tend to plan ahead?
Or do you B, deal with things as they come?
Yes.
All right, we got some folks already in there.
Love it.
Hey, Gami, thank you, as always. I think tasting kind of brings to the place you need to taste. Very easy to overdo it.
Yes.
All right, we're getting some notes there.
All right, everybody. Oh yeah, I see these coming in. Okay, so these are the four money personalities.
If you would like to take this with your family or with friends or coworkers, you can go to brunch.com/personality and check it out there.
Yes. So our money personalities are our tendencies and our relationship with money. And really what this means is when you know your money personality, you're able to filter out financial advice that you get coming at you all the time. Mm-hmm. Because some financial advice totally makes sense to you and totally resonates. And some of it just doesn't, but you try something and it doesn't work and you're like, oh, I guess I'm bad at this. But no, it just didn't fit in with your money personality and your tendencies.
This is a combination of feeling stuff and real for real brain science. Like here, let me tell you a real for real brain science thing about goals. You know how everybody tells you that you should be writing down your goals? Not necessarily. For another segment of the population, because for some people, right, writing down your goals makes it understandable and concrete and the thing you can reach towards. For some people, psychologically, writing down a goal does a trick in your brain and makes you think that you've already gotten it, so you do less work trying to reach it.
That's me.
So similarly, with these money personalities, it's not that the financial advice is bad. It's not even that you're bad at handling the financial advice. It's that your experiences, your understanding, and just your plain old body is not going to do these things in this order. So we have to find the ways that work for us.
Yes. So if you answered A for one and A for two, or if you think that someone in your life might be an AA, you might be a complicator. And complicators,
it's two A's for a reason. The
it's
type
two A's
thing
for
is,
a reason.
Is not a coincidence.
Exactly. We complicate things. We really do. I mean, I think I shared before, I've literally like spent 3 days researching to find out, like, to make sure I got the best dishwasher. I know. Oh my God. When we had to buy a car, that was like spreadsheets, 20 tabs open, all these different things, looking up like things I'd never even heard of before to make sure that I was getting the right warranty and the right whatever, and the right tires or whatever it was. complicators, we complicate things because we want to make sure that we are doing the best, most optimal financial thing. And I will tell you right now, yes, overthink everything, exactly. We want to make sure we're doing the best thing. And I will tell you right now, complicators, there's no such thing as the best thing.
Well, as the partner of a complicator, one thing that I found that's really interesting is that it's not just, well, because we were talking about the relationship stuff with this one. And I think, you know, it's not just about when there's more money, because it's easy to say, well, when I'm buying a car, of course I'm going to overcomplicate things because it's an expensive purchase. But that was the reason why you overcomplicated things. It was because there were many details.
True.
And what happens with complicators, complicators are excellent with the details so that they don't miss these little things that slip. But what happens is you can get caught up in these details. That's the can't see the forest for the trees kind of thing.
He sees me, y'all.
Well, I mean, that's the point of these money person eyes, right? So that we can see ourselves.
Lori, it took me 3 years to choose a laptop. For real. Oh my God. I feel like I just started buying Apple laptops so I didn't have to decide anymore. I was like, okay, they just have the one.
That's an excellent point. One of the ways that complicators get taken advantage of is this decision fatigue. And that's where cats will just come and be like, hey, have you spent 5 hours researching this thing? Well, let me give you some substandard product because you're tired of now looking at the specs. And all of that work then feels like it was for nothing. So with complicators, we want to find ways that you can let go of stuff. And we talked about how you would automate some bill pays and things like that. But the reason is we want to free up space in your mind so you can remember why you started complicating. You started complicating because you wanted to make sure that you were ready to buy or save for the things that you need.
Yes, exactly. Thank you.
Yeah, no, if you answered A for one and B for two, you might be a contemplator. Contemplator is very similar to the complicators. The thing about the contemplators, they really love mess. Contemplators are the ones who love mess. It's chaos. You know, while the complicator gets into every single detail
to make sure there's no chaos,
the contemplator is like, you know, the chaos is fine, because when those details start flying at me is when I'm going to start dealing with them. Yep. When you start hitting me with late fees is when I'm going to start worrying about late fees. When you start hitting me with complications and the things that I got put together and is this speaker going to be better than the other one and those tires, I'll deal with them as they come. And mind you, contemplators are great at that. You would think that they had spent all this time researching and putting it together. But the problem is that contemplators tend to wait until that last minute. Wait until the stuff is hitting the fan for them to try to do anything. And what happens is it leaves it so that you're not in control. And it leaves it so that if you do get overwhelmed, you have no recourse. And that often leads to bad credit. One of the things that we worry about the most with contemplators is ignoring a bill or ignoring some sort of charge that they may either consider unjust or not a high priority. Yeah. And next thing you know, you forgot about it and it's in collections and it's messing with your credit. And yes, that's 7 years.
I've worked with a lot of contemplators who have the money in the bank for the bills and who really just like the way that you want to feel in control is that you don't want to think about it until you have to. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, if you can set it up so that you don't have to think about it at all, that's another level of control that as a contemplator really can work for you.
Yeah. One of the things I think contemplators have a good read on this. We talk a lot about spending and psychology of it. And you really only spend money for two reasons, because you want the thing mm-hmm. that you're spending money on, or two, because you want the feeling of being in control that that thing gives you.
Yep.
And with contemplators, the feeling of being in control is so powerful that the way that contemplators often get taken advantage of is, hey, watch out, I'm going to take this whole system for you and you don't have to worry about anything. Subscription services tend to get contemplators a lot.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. If you answered B for one and A for two, you might be a paper chaser. Mm-hmm. And paper chaser's solution to their money problems is, I'll just make more money and it will solve all the problems, right?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, you know, higher salaries would solve like lots of people's problems.
It's true. It's true. And paper chasers, you see those opportunities and you're like, hey, I want this thing. You're amazing at short-term planning. You're amazing at seeing like, okay, I want this thing. I need to get from point A to point B. And this is exactly how I'm going to get there. And these are all the tools that I'm going to pull in to get me to that point. And because you're so great at seeing those opportunities and you're so great at short-term planning, the long-term planning tends to fall by the wayside. And what that often means with paper chasers is instead of saving money, instead of putting money in a savings account, you want the money to feel like it's in motion because you want it to feel like it's doing something. And so often paper chasers, when they want something, will instead find ways to make more income versus saving and cutting back on expenses.
Yeah, one thing that I want to say for paper chases, I feel like this applies to money monks a lot too. A reason why you want to think more about long-term planning is imposter syndrome. I think the paper chasers and money monks are very prone to imposter syndrome because as a paper chaser, you're great at short-term planning, putting together this project that will work. That doesn't necessarily mean that the next project is going to work because you haven't created replicable projects. You keep iterating and making new things. Creating a long-term plan and setting all the processes and laying them all out, as boring as it sounds and as inflexible as it sounds, is going to give you the structure so that when things fall off, when things don't work out, whether it's your fault or any other reason, you still know that you do what you do and can keep it moving.
Yes, yes.
And if you answered B for one and B for two, you might be a money monk. Money monks are a lot of educators, creatives. I'm a money monk. It's always, I'm doing this because I'm a money monk.
I'm right? married to a money monk.
Well, you know what? Yeah, you know, oftentimes, by the way, as we talk about relationship things, did we mention we were married before? I don't know if that was
married. A married. That's reveal, why we're whatever. Next to each other right now.
we could have been on other Zooms. Anyway, you will often find either diametric opposites or vertical and horizontal opposites with these things. And as a money monk, I'm always concerned about the big picture, and the big picture being in like the world, is this okay what I'm doing? Am I making money? Am I able to take care of my, am I able to take care of myself, but not just take care of myself, take care of my whole community? And one of the things about being a money monk is it gets daunting. And you get this idea that if I'm not fixing everything,
yeah,
why am I fixing nothing? Then forget it. And money monks, I can tell y'all, there have been times when I've skipped out on gigs.
There have been times where he hasn't cashed a check because he was unhappy with how the gig went. Mm-hmm. And he was unhappy with the relationship. With the organization, like he just like I have a vivid memory of him literally putting a check on the fridge and saying, never cashing this, these guys suck,
they mistreated me, it was small money, and they spelled my name wrong on the check, which I thought was like on purpose so that I wouldn't have to cash it or something like that. Money monks, we do all of these things, and it's important for us to be able to get our code together and to know what's real. But again, big picture, long term. Yeah. If what you want to do is save the world, or even just, you know, save the whales, or you have a smaller goal, it often is community based. The community that you're going to help, that you want to help, relies on you, and you have to have your stuff together as much as possible. And that means digging into and interrogating your feelings around money and making sure that you have a financial base, because stuff is going to hit the fan. You've seen that. You're warning everybody. You got the Cassandra complex, but make sure that you've got, you know, a complex for them to hide out in after it all goes down.
Yes, I love it. I feel like with money monks, figuring out what your bigger why is behind even the more mundane financial tasks is going to be super important for you to get through them and move forward to that bigger vision that you're looking for.
Our relationship-y people, if you work with or love or both with a money monk, one of the best ways to get them out of any meandering is to make sure that they're clear about the goals and what's going to happen when you do the great change and do the good things for the community. Then you will find money monks acting like complicators, acting like paper chasers,
yeah,
finding ways to get money even though they act like they don't want it.
If you are interested in diving more deep on money personalities and relationships, we've actually done 2 podcast episodes on them. It's called... I have to look.
One is talking to your honey about money.
Yeah, talking to your honey about money. And then, yeah.
Rhymes are easier to remember. That's why you rhyme stuff.
Yeah, we will send Angela those links so she can send them out to you.
Mm-hmm.
So share in the chat. What do you need?
We should have let you.
I know. Next time we'll mention it.
So we've been talking a lot. So we'd like to hear from y'all. DJ KK47 is going to run a couple of tunes. It's 7:34. We'll come back at 7:36. What do you need to feel like you're on the road to your financial legacy, income, opportunities, a plan? I would like to invite our peoples who have been here with us before, if you could get a little bit more detailed about the things that you need, especially since you've gone through a couple of these sessions and you have a few ideas. Yes, let's run that for the next couple of minutes. We'll be right back.
cash it. Thank you, KK47.
Oh yeah, keep throwing stuff in there. I saw a raised hand.
Laura, did you raise your hand? Did you have a question? Feel free to unmute yourself if you want to say it out loud.
You might be throwing in the chat. That's cool too. Oh yeah. We'll shout out a few of these here. Folks talking about needing more income and a better job. That's often the case. Jobs are, when we talk about relationships, jobs are also places that we get a relationship with and feel like we're stuck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to read this one too. Investments, how I can earn income without working, and the next generation can inherit dividends. I love that. Yes, there's things like Roth IRAs that can allow you to do that tax-free. A plan and income, proper investments, more around investing, a business plan, strong client base, active and passive income.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. You know, I was saying this last time about how passive income is mostly paying you back for the work that you've done. But like on the real, whenever we're getting into the passive income thing, there's generally a big active component to it.
Yes.
Until we are in the space where we're talking about very large amounts of money, and then it kind of trudges along by itself.
Yes, exactly. Yes, a Roth IRA. So Roth IRA, there's income limits on if you can contribute. I think you have to make less than $142,000, something mm-hmm. like that. It changes every year. But with a Roth IRA, there's a maximum contribution limit. So every year you're able to contribute up to $6,000 mm-hmm. into a Roth IRA. You actually still have until April 18th, to contribute for 2021. But the thing that's great about a Roth IRA is you put in the money, you put in the $6,000, right? You don't get a tax deduction now, but all of the money that's in the Roth IRA grows tax free. And if you don't use that money in your lifetime, you pass it on to your beneficiaries tax free, and they get to use that money tax free in their generation.
But by the way, acronym madness, I see you've got RIA, IRA. You would talk to an RIA, a registered investment advisor, about your individual IRA, retirement yes. account.
Yeah. And an IRA is invested in the stock market, actually. So it doesn't collect interest. You can put it in a savings account if you want, but the benefit of an IRA is that you want it to grow over a long period of time, which means that you put it into investments. You put it into an investment account.
Yeah. And it's not just one stock. You're in a fully diversified portfolio. So its tendency is to grow, to be very simple about the stock market thing. The stock market grows as long as America does. Basically, if you have yourself invested in a fully diversified account, you're invested in so many companies that if your portfolio goes down, that means that we are living in martial law and it's anarchy in the streets.
Yes, exactly. So the thing about investing in the stock market is it's not risky if you're fully diversified and you plan to keep that money in there for a very long period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And that's something too. I'm trying to think, we probably have entire podcast series on investing and going through all of that as well.
Well, I mean, especially for my Money Monks, when we talk about the podcast, there's a two-part series called Investing for Dummy Elect, where I talk about the fact that I think that the stock market is a bad thing. It is, y'all. It's a bad thing. It makes companies do stuff that they're not supposed to do.
Oh, he's such a money monk. But I still convinced him to get a Roth IRA.
Well, the real is, for all of my folks who are like, yeah, you know, stock market, they ain't doing us good. These companies are already taking advantage of us. And it's up to us to try to get a little bit out of them from what they're already taking from us in the purchases that we make. And even if you're not spending money with these companies, the people around you are. So it affects you and your community.
Yes. Yes, it does. All right.
So let's pull back.
I love that. I could talk about investments all day.
I know we got on rant mode. And we're happy. I mean, as we're in this stage, and I saw a lot of people asking about that, feel free to throw us your randoms and we'll get to that.
We're happy to. So the six money topics, if you look at your worksheet down on the left-hand column, are one, earn. So talking about income, taxes, and career.
Two is your spending, your bills, discretionary spending, things like that.
Yep. Three is save. So knowing what your savings milestones are and what you're saving for.
And borrow includes credit and debt and everything with that.
Yes. The next money topic is invest, which is stocks, bonds, and real estate.
Mm-hmm. And all the stuff that you got, your cryptos, your commodities, mm-hmm. everything. And then protect, insurance, and estate planning.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
And today we are focusing on the protect stage, because when you're in financial sustainability, a lot of folks who get to this point don't protect their wealth.
Well, that's because in the stages before, it seemed silly. When you're in your safety stage, you're like, what am I protecting? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. Well, I mean, out of my money, I can't give you 20% of it because then that means I'm not going to have enough for food.
Yep. Exactly. So when you're in the financial sustainability stage, if you found yourself here accidentally, if you're like, oh, I've done all the things in safety and stability, and now I'm here and what do I do? Really, it's all about making sure that your wealth is protected. If you own a home, making sure that's protected. If you own cars, if you own investments, all of those kinds of things, these are the kinds of things you need to make sure are passed down. We actually did a podcast episode also with an estate planner who said that she believes that estate planning, proper estate planning, is the number one way to end generational poverty.
I mean, yo, the fact that folks tell you that you need to have $5 million to have a real estate is part of the game. It's one of the reasons why a lot of folks who don't have $5 million don't start planning for their estate. And the small amounts of money, the amount of money and things that they would have been able to pass down, don't get passed down. And then, as we're saying about how you can stumble through these stages, there are plenty of rich, famous folks who died without any sort of estate plan. Yep, and they were doing tons of good in the community. And now it's going nowhere.
So in protect, in the financial safety stage, what that looks like is that you've insured your health and well-being. You got to make sure you have health insurance in the financial safety stage. If you are beyond this stage and you don't have health insurance, please prioritize that. The next thing is in financial stability. I've protected my income and my loved ones. That means making sure you have life insurance. That means making sure you have disability insurance in place. If you rent your apartment, that means making sure you have renter's insurance in place.
I mean, the main thing that takes us out as people is medical issues. The main economic thing that takes us out as people is medical debt. And then that's medical debt for ourselves and our loved ones.
Yes, exactly. And then the financial sustainability stage is really putting together an estate plan so you pass your wealth on based on your wishes. And then in the financial independence stage, you're going through advanced estate planning strategies, setting up trusts, setting up ways to circumvent paying estate taxes, things like that. And then the financial legacy stage, you're really at the point where you're protecting the wealth so you can pass this legacy on to the next generation.
Mm-hmm. That's when we get to very complicated things.
Yes, exactly. So share in the chat. We'll give you another couple of minutes. Which stage do you think you're at right now in the protect row?
Yeah, and we'll pull it back so you can check it out.
Mm-hmm. Yep, we'll be back at 7:46.
Yeah, take 2 minutes. Okay, you better think. Now's the time when we have it yet. That's the thing I never will forget. Now, baby, I got a life to live and a whole lot of love that I want to give. Yeah. But before I give it up, I gotta think. What the future holds for me. Right, thanks, y'all. Well, now this is my kind of cleaning music. This is the kind of jams that I'd be like to clean the house so I can dance.
This is my estate planning music.
word. I think you need to have the same kind of energy.
We should have estate planning music for real. Lauren, thank you for sharing none of them. I feel that the protect stage is.
We asked y'all because it's one of the hardest.
Yeah, it's the kind of thing that we always think we can put off until later. Mm-hmm. The thing about the protect stage is. financial safety is making sure that you have health insurance. And if you don't know where to start in the protect stage at all, get health insurance, because it is the number one cause. Medical debt is the number one cause of bankruptcy in the United States. Mm-hmm. And when the Affordable Care Act went into effect 4 years from when it started versus, 4 years from when it started, bankruptcy filings went down by half. It went from 1.5 million people filing for bankruptcy to 750,000 people filing for bankruptcy. It's huge.
And we know the ACA has a lot of problems.
We do.
So just imagine that even with all those problems, it cut it in half.
Yeah.
So if you're listening to all this and you're like, yeah, like that's all true, but I looked at how much it would cost for me to insure myself and I need to spend that money on other stuff. Cool. We're not going to argue with you in this point. We know that you need to figure out when this is going to happen. So please add this to your timeline. Yes. Figure out when you're going to find time to get this money together for your health insurance.
Oh, and Lauren said, had it when it came out, then it became out of budget later. Mm-hmm. It has gotten more expensive, but the subsidies have also grown with it. So it might be worth checking to see if it's become more affordable again. I also know a lot of subsidy programs in specific states have changed and increased as well, including Medicaid.
And I know that for a lot of us, we just need to be making more income so that we're able to do that. So like we said, when we're putting together this entire grid of what we need, that's on the list of what we need to make sure that we've got what we have.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. Thank you for sharing that, because health insurance feels like it's so hard to get right now too.
Yeah. And that's so messy.
Yes. So we're going to talk about creating an estate plan today. Mm-hmm. And this is something that you can start doing at any stage. It becomes very important in sustainability. But like I said earlier, starting to build that foundation while you're in safety and stability means that by the time you get to sustainability, you'll be in a really good place where you're protecting your wealth.
Okay. So the estate plan that's going to pass on your wealth based on your wishes. Your goal is to make sure that it's fully in place while you're accumulating wealth, while you're putting your stuff together before you're even done.
Yeah. The biggest challenge here is as you begin to accomplish major goals, which means you're most likely accumulating major assets, right? You have to make sure that you protect those assets along the way. Again, we mentioned earlier, proper estate planning is the number one way your wealth is passed on to the next generation in the way that you want it passed on.
And I know a lot of folks are talking about, well, we need to get these investments and have that all together so that we can pass that along. Again, this is what the plan will help you figure out.
Yes, exactly. So the estate planning documents these are kind of the big four to think about. The first one is a healthcare proxy. And we actually recommend that no matter what stage you're in, you get this, you set this up for yourself. This allows someone to make healthcare decisions on your behalf. Everybody needs this. Then we have the power of attorney, which gives someone the ability to handle financial matters. We're actually going to go more in depth into each one. We have the will, which is most important if you have kids and if you have property or taxable investments. If you don't have a will and you have those things, the state decides for you.
And then this is the dirty word, trust. Right? It's because it's a good word. We should trust things, but everyone has a stigma about trust fund kids and things like that. Trusts are the things that allow you to sidestep the court system. If you thought you had to deal with the court system too much in life and death, it's even worse. It allows you to just do the thing that you want to do because they trust you.
Yes, exactly. So let's talk about what happens if you die without a will.
Okay, so dying without a will is called intestate, which sounds like your guts are the highway. It's terrible. You go to a probate judge and they decide on all the stuff.
Yes, they decide who is going to take care of your kids.
You know, the part in the movie about the orphan where there's some disaffected judge just rattling off a list of stuff that they don't know anything about. That's how it works. And it's expensive.
They have this basic guide for how things are distributed, but the most important thing is at the bottom. If you're partnered but not married, you have no legal claim to the estate, even if you help build these assets up. If you are domestic partners, not all states recognize domestic partners.
I mean, this was the big crux of the call for marriage equality.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Speaking of.
So yeah, Prince had like a huge estate. And I don't know if y'all know how much Prince spent money and energy on financial, economic, and education initiatives for Black youth. He had all sorts of money in the schools, and all of those things just ended. And the people who are getting paid right now are the lawyers who are messing around with it in probate court.
Yeah. So far, what is that number? Like $9 million in fees and expenses have gone to lawyers. His heirs have not seen any of his money because he died without a will. Aretha Franklin also died without a will. Mm-hmm. I remember James Gandolfini died without a trust. So everyone saw his will. Woof.
Yeah, we'll talk about the trust thing and how that yes. protects you in other ways other than economic in a second. So when you die with a will, you this have an executor, not an executor, who will file a petition. I know it's like not good language, a petition for the probate in the county that you died in. They'll publish the probate filing in a newspaper, it's a process, notify your y'all. Family members.
If you're an executor for anyone in your family, or if you don't know, if you're like maybe an executor for your parents, like find out, because this is everything that you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You got to go before the judge. The judge is going to decide if the will is valid. If you have property in other states, your executor has to go to every different state that you have property in and file probate in each of those states.
Yeah, it's not a lot of fun. So talking about wills, they don't solve everything. And like Pam was saying earlier, they're public record, which means anybody can get access to them. That's why people know about what happens with celebrities when they die without a will, because it's just there.
Yeah, or if they die with a will, but not a trust. Everything right. is public record. So I was mm-hmm. saying James Gandolfini gifted his secretary $400,000 and it made headlines, and they found out because his will was public record. Yeah. And the real thing is that a judge is going to still determine if it's valid or not.
Mm-hmm.
So you can bypass probate court actually for free pretty easily. This is also something that no matter what stage you're in, you can do. If you have a 401k or a 403b at work, if you have an IRA, if you open that Roth IRA, Angela, make sure you list a beneficiary.
If you're not familiar with any of those terms, those are all retirement accounts.
Yes. You can also put beneficiaries on pensions and mm-hmm. on life insurance. What that means is whoever you name as the beneficiary automatically gets the money when you pass away. It avoids probate court altogether. The same thing can happen with bank accounts and non-IRA investment accounts. It's called a transfer on death, and you can list a transfer on death on your checking and savings accounts right now. Go to the bank. You might be able to even do it online.
Yeah.
If you list someone as a transfer on death, that money does not go through the court system at all. It does not pass through any lawyer's hands at all.
Oh, word.
Oh, yes, Lauren. Yes, just learned about this as I'm a beneficiary, right? And it just like the money just came to you.
It just happens.
Yep. Yep. I love it.
So yeah, again, probate court, it's free, no public record. All of these things, you know, it sounds stressful to set these types of things up, but I find them really important so that one, you and your family, whoever is still around, has the ability to mourn. Because the thing that I think sucks the most when you don't have money and you suffer losses in your family is that there's that squabble. Everyone has to fight and scramble and get their stuff together. We're getting a headstone, we're a nice headstone, we're nice this, or yeah. like, is it nice enough and all that? And then you're emotional, mm-hmm. you're behind, and that's when you don't get to make the decisions you want.
Yep, exactly. So this is general advice. I'm gonna say this right now because a lot of attorneys, depending on the state, we'll say that a trust might be too much. It might be one step too far, mm-hmm. right? Our attorney, when we talked to him, we're actually putting together our estate plan now, 2.5 years after our child is born. I know.
Well, that's another yeah. thing to be okay with yourself on. These things do take a while. They take a while to convince yourself, and they take a while to make some of these decisions.
Yes, but a trust is something where you can avoid probate court altogether.
Mm-hmm.
What that means is you put in a lot of work up front to put together the trust, right? And so we have to choose trustees. We have to choose secondary trustees. We have to pay for an attorney to create this trust document separate from the will, right? But the thing is, when you have the trust set in place, then everything that you put in the trust avoids probate court altogether. Mm-hmm. You don't have to go through a judge. You don't have to hire a separate lawyer to like go through the 4 months of probate court. I know in Brooklyn in particular, we were talking to an estate attorney, and they said that it takes 4 months just to get an appointment in probate court.
Minimum.
Yeah. So the thing about a trust is it bypasses the probate court, and the trustee, whoever you name, it's equivalent to the executor in the will, is the one who distributes all the assets. And you can name the trust as the beneficiary. So you just have to update the trust document. You put major assets in the trust name. So we are actually, once our trust is set up, we're going to put the deed mm-hmm. in our trust name. We're going to have the beneficiary for all of our accounts be in the trust name. And so the trust gets everything. And then we just have to decide, who the beneficiaries of the trust are and how we want that money distributed to them.
It gives you simplicity and a degree of privacy.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's the other thing. A trust is not public record.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Nobody knows what it says in your trust.
All right, we share the, you know, you with trust, you have options. You know, yes, when people talk about like trust fund kids, right? They're mm-hmm. like, well, what's with the trust fund kids? And oftentimes the trust fund kids are something where they have a lump sum of money, but they get it in intervals.
Yes.
They get it regularly, like a paycheck.
That's actually a conversation that we still have to have about our kid, right?
Right, yeah, because we're thinking about what would we want to do with that?
Yeah, because the thing about setting up a trust is it's not that the money automatically goes to your kid if you die. The thing is, you can say, I only want them to get a third of the money when they're 20, and then the next third when they're 25, mm-hmm. and then they can get the rest of the money when they're 35. Whatever you want to say, you can set up a trust so that if you feel like one of your kids, you want them to wait a little bit longer because you don't know if they're going to be responsible with money, mm-hmm. you can set up separate kinds of trusts called spendthrift trusts, where they're only allowed to access the money for certain reasons or for certain expenses, things like that. There's all of these different ways you get to choose how the money gets distributed. And this is another way to preserve wealth until your kids get older.
You know, there's this media thing about the trust fund kid, the stigma about the trust fund kid being lazy, being shiftless, being not motivated to do things.
Yep.
And that's not really the truth. While, you know, there's your Carltons and stuff that you see on TV, but the Carltons of the world end up senators and judges and captains of whatever industry they're in.
Yep.
So these are the ways that we can set our kids up for success, whether or not they're mediocre kids or if they're exceptional, they'll have the options to try to do what they want.
If you are trying to build generational wealth, you have to have an estate plan in place.
I mean, this is how rich folks build generational wealth. There's a stat that, what is it? 70% of generational wealth is lost within one generation on average.
And 90% of that wealth is lost within two generations.
So even amongst the wealthy, they have an understanding that if they don't put together processes, they can lose what they got.
Yep, exactly. All right. So good peer pressure. What is it that you're going to do next to set up or update your estate plan? And who will you protect by doing this?
And I would love for you to also, this is like the time when you can start sharing some of your other questions about the things that we've been going over, yep. some of the things we mentioned. We were talking about your estate planning. We also mentioned a couple of investing things. I know that's not what today's workshop is about, but we can answer a couple of those before we get out of here.
Yeah. KK47, are you there?
KK, if you could run a couple of tunes.
Oh, I think it's a little quiet. There we go.
Sasha, go ahead. You got
Sasha, go ahead. I need a will. Oh, great question. Do I need a will or a trust or both? Ah, yes.
KK, can you bring it down a little bit to bed level? Okay, this is a complicated one.
Yes.
Great question.
So you need a will no matter what. So even if you don't set up a trust, you need a will. A will and a trust will usually, if you set up a trust, then your attorney will automatically set up a will. Because anything that isn't named to be going to the trust ends up passing through the will instead.
Mm-hmm.
So usually when you have a trust set up, the attorney will set up what's called a pour over will.
Mm-hmm.
So anything that for some reason, maybe you like missed an account that didn't end up in the trust, that will end up going through the will. Also, if you have children, then a will is the only place where you can name guardians.
Yeah, as far as order of operations go, we would recommend you start with the will because that will be what you want. Get all that together and then decide, are you ready for, or do you need a trust? And then add that.
It's definitely worth talking to an estate attorney to figure out when it makes sense to put in a trust versus a will. In general, what I've seen is that attorneys will tend to recommend you have a trust if you have a property, if you have multiple properties in multiple states, that way your family doesn't have to go to multiple states to actually go through the court system.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's another good question. Have you heard of a transfer on death with a DMV for vehicles that are free and clear?
Ooh.
And will that still need to go through probate?
Oh my God, I'm going to look that up right now. Actually, I haven't, because the thing about vehicles is, yeah, that's a really good point. Vehicles usually have to go through probate court. Let me see.
Just period, right?
Transfer on death for vehicles. I haven't heard of that myself. I don't know if you transfer ownership when the vehicle is deceased. Please bring a copy of the death certificate. How transfers on death beneficiaries claim vehicles. Oh, you can do transfers on death for vehicles. If a car was registered using a TOD form, probate won't be necessary. The beneficiary just using the title and death certificate.
So you have to get a transfer on death form for the registration.
Tanya, I'm adding these to our presentations. Thank you for bringing that up. I did not know you could do that. And I feel like in particular, passing on a vehicle is usually a headache.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like imagine having to go through court to like inherit like an old car. Mm-hmm. You can't just take it.
Actually, I'm thinking about when I've been around that, I haven't heard of that happening.
Yeah. Ooh, best recommendations for estate attorneys. So it's tricky because attorneys are licensed per state.
Yeah, that's the tough thing about it.
I'm actually going to check if our estate attorney is registered in New Jersey because a lot of New York ones are registered. Sasha, are you in New Jersey? Let me see.
Because we've got some good New York stuff, but a number of ours are in New Jersey.
No, a number of ours are in New York. Oh, wait, hold on. Let me see.
No, he's just in New York.
Is he just licensed in New York?
Okay. Let's see.
I do have some New Jersey folks, actually. Hold on. Let me look up my list.
Oh, I love this from Lauren. I need money first, so I don't have anything much to leave unless they want to fight for my Funko Pops and Pokemon cards. I mean, when it comes to that kind of stuff, when it means things to you, even if they aren't worth a ton of money. And also, you know how Pokemon cards are back? I don't know if you know. Like Pokemon cards are worth some money right now. You never know when them Funko Pops, if you got the rare one,
is that tomorrow app?
How that is going to blow you up.
I was going to look up, there was an app called Tomorrow, but now I'm like, maybe it doesn't exist anymore.
The Tomorrow app, is that not around anymore?
Tomorrow app estate planning. Because you can just set up a free tomorrow.me. Oh, they changed the name. It's now Ethos. Tomorrow is now part of Ethos. Okay.
It was bought by Ethos.
Yes. So tomorrow.me was bought by Ethos, but the website is still tomorrow.me. And they still do, I think, free. They'll help you set up a free will. And I'm looking up, actually, let me just email Angela because I know that we have estate attorneys in New Jersey in particular that clients have worked with that they like.
Word.
Yeah. Yes.
Otherwise, thank you all so much.
I think this is it. Let's see. There we go.
Yeah, if you want to know any more about what we have going on, feel free to reach out. Again, before we get out of here now, if you have any of these questions, these are all really good things. And I want you to remember, really, everything that you're building, everything that you've created is a part of your estate. And think about how to build, I think the only TED Talk I ever liked, I'm sorry if you love TED Talks, I don't really like them. I think they're nonsense. But the only good TED Talk I ever liked was one where they talked about build the world that you want to see when you're gone. And think about what that entails. Whether you are super rich and you've got all the money by the time you die, that's cool. You can put that in places. But even if you don't have a ton of money, what do you do in your life that builds the world you want to see after you're gone?
All right, Brunch and Budget. Thank you so much for taking us on this world tour. Please, everyone, it's not too late to encourage your family, your community, your loved ones, your students to join next week. Financial independence, same bat time, same bat channel. This program has been brought to you by Brookdale Community College's Community College Opportunity Grant. Let's get comfortable talking about money. Thanks, y'all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Always great jamming with y'all.
Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next week.
And thanks for sharing. We really appreciate all of that. It's a getting me. So it's a take, yeah.